are in the backyard of Linda Connolly, who lives here in Hopkinton. It's beautiful here in late August. And my friend Sylvester is on my lap, who's going to join us for the interview today. Come and join this conversation amidst friends. Hi, Linda.
Hi, Cheryl.
Thank you for having me at your home in your backyard. And who do we have here on your chair?
This is Big Red.
Big Red.
This is Big Red.
Ah, hello, Big Red. Wow, just wanted to come by and say hello as we got started here. It's lovely in your yard.
Thank you very much.
I had asked for meeting at a place that you love in Hopkinton in this town, and so we are here in your backyard mm-hmm. where I understand you spend a good amount of your time. Can you talk about the draw a little bit?
Sure, yes, we're really fortunate. We live behind us, there are about 60 acres of land owned by a couple of brothers, two or three brothers, so we literally have a forest behind us. So
It's beautiful and
just
cool.
Amazing wildlife, really amazing wildlife mm-hmm. in the town here.
And you have your own little
which is little chickens. Yep, chickens and dogs.
And on the other side we have the dog.
Yep. We have Sylvester. Here, uh-huh. Who's a little upset that they're getting all the fun.
Sylvester gets spaghetti. Just like Lady and the Tramp. And behind we have one more.
Yes, and that's Maisie. Yeah, Maisie. Oh look, she's sneaking.
Yeah,
she's sneaking some spaghetti. It's not really chicken food. Yeah.
So you spend a good amount of time outside here near the forest with your animal friends.
Well, certainly this time of year. Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And it's very cool here.
Yeah, very nice. Yeah, that the woods keep it a little bit cooler in the uh-huh. summer. Yeah, but we have hummingbirds uh-huh. and we have deer and fox and amazing amount of a variety of creatures that hang out in the backyard.
Well, I can see why. It certainly is a beautiful setting. And yeah, you're not far from the center of town. You wouldn't know it.
Yeah.
And you have a beautiful garden I see to the right of me with some tomatoes and sunflowers. Would you say you keep busy a lot in the backyard?
Yeah, we do a lot of gardening. I love the flowers and the chickens. yeah, I do. You know, this time of year, it's short. So you have to take it when it comes because we have such a long winter here.
Yes.
You know?
Oh. Well, speaking of chickens, why chickens in Hopkinton, a suburb of Hopkinton?
Oh, it's a happening thing now. Everybody wants chickens, or everybody should have chicken. Very easy to care for.
Uh-huh.
They're very inexpensive and they're hardy.
They make a nice song.
They do. They make nice little cooing sounds, but they, you know, very, they're friendly. They're much like a pet. Uh-huh. But even better still, they give you eggs that the dogs take, but they don't give anything back. Uh-huh. They don't give eggs.
So. Yeah, so you get a food source in the same way as you get tomatoes and things from your garden.
Yeah.
You're collecting eggs. How many would you say with
Well, I'm down to
chickens?
These two, and the two new ones are too young to be laying yet. But when I had the three, she's going to be pecking after me.
My toes being pecked.
It could be as many as 21 eggs a week.
21
Which
eggs
is a lot,
week.
You
wow.
know? And they taste so much better than what you buy at the store, you know?
Really?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
That is motivating to have a few chickens. Do you have to be zoned a certain way to have chickens?
Well, you know, it's agricultural zoning around here. It may be that there are some communities that don't allow it. And I'm not sure about roosters.
Yeah.
You might not be, because they're, you know, very loud and disruptive.
Yes.
So I think you might need to have not be able to have roosters here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. But this works really well, and it gives you a food source. That is good. And how about the maintenance for having
very little. We have a nice setup with the chicken house. So, you know, just a few minutes in the morning, and then maybe once a week I'd rake out the house itself and put down some fresh pine shavings.
Wow.
You know, uh-huh. but they're not a lot of maintenance.
That doesn't sound too bad.
No, I mean, that's at this scale. I'm sure if you had a dozen or more,
yeah.
it's a lot of work, but.
My mother grew up with 2,000 and she has a different perspective.
Yeah, I'm sure she does.
But this sounds manageable.
Yeah.
And they get along for the most part with
for
dogs.
For the most part, yeah.
Right? Well, it is obvious that you do love the outdoors. I know also that you're a bird watcher. You keep a sight of birds coming through. Would you say you
Are you an official bird watcher? Do you go out? And...
Well, I'm more interested in kind of what comes into the backyard. Okay. But there's a great variety that comes into the backyard. Yeah. I have in my life taken trips with binoculars, but not lately. But I mean, there's a lot here. Yeah. I saw today, I think it was, I'm assuming it was a Baltimore Oriole.
Really,
yeah, taking a bath there. Because I'm not sure though, it was either, it could have been that or a rufous-sided towhee, which is also a black and rust-colored bird.
More unusual.
So yeah, a little bit, yeah. So yeah. I'm not sure. I couldn't quite figure that one out. But yeah, bluebirds come in the winter. Mm. And
in the winter. I've
been trying to photograph them. I have been photographing them because they're just such a pretty bird.
Yeah. Yeah. What would you say that witnessing the change in seasons here and the wildlife, wanting to photograph it, noting changes and newcomers and beautiful colors, what does that do for you? Or a person,
In general? It makes you appreciate the changes of the seasons.
Yeah.
Appreciate the outdoors, mm-hmm. you know?
Mm-hmm.
And you have to come to this understanding that it's not going to stay the same. The summer is so short and the winter is so long, but it's nice to be looking at the birds and feed the birds in the winter as a way to get through the cold patches.
Get through the hard times, the cold patches. It sounds like it's something good for your well-being.
Yeah,
is what you're
absolutely. Absolutely.
So, about Hopkinton, have you lived here forever in town?
We have been here 21 years.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
21 years in October.
Mm, where did you come from before that?
I lived in Needham for 10 years prior to that, and 10 years before that, I lived in Cambridge.
Okay.
For about a period of 8 years. I was in Central Square, Cambridge, so keep coming farther out, more green.
But Massachusetts residents?
Yes, I'm just,
Most
and I did,
life,
I grew up in Auburndale. Oh, here comes the cat.
Oh, the cat.
Yeah, yeah.
And what brought you to Hopkinton?
I had a teaching job in Holliston, so I was commuting from Needham to Holliston. So I became aware of this section of the state.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a little bit different than it wasn't. It was more affordable at that time than Needham and the suburbs right next to Boston.
Uh-huh.
So, and more trees, so that was why I came
more
this
trees.
Way. More trees, You get older, you need more trees.
I agree, trees for everyone.
Yeah.
And is this where you settled down in your beautiful home off the beaten path and raised your family?
Yep, this is. Mm-hmm. We've been here 21 years. I raised a son and a daughter. Son is 21, daughter is 27. Both went to Hopkinton schools, but they're pretty much fledged. They're gone.
They're gone.
Yeah, for the moment.
Yes, and. So in raising them in Hopkinton, what would you say was one of the advantages?
There are a lot of opportunities for children in the town, so much to do. You know, my son was involved in drama, so there was plenty happening. My daughter did photography and art, but a lot. If you want to get involved and whatever niche it is that you're interested in, it's there.
Uh-huh. So theater, art. In addition to the outdoors that you value. So something for everyone, like you said. And just curious, in parenting, what would you say that you learned from the years of parenting as if it were a school?
What did I learn? It's very fast. It goes by.
It goes by so fast,
You know, and the stress and the all of the emphasis on the... you know, the doing well in the schools and making it on to the next stage in life with it. That's overrated, all that rushing around. We didn't really need to do it.
Not all that rushing.
Yeah, you know, or the competitive nature of it. So for people who are still have children in the schools, they need to relax a little bit more and not be so focused on the whole college thing because it'll happen and, you know, things fall into place.
Yeah.
Well, you don't have to push it.
How do you reverse that message?
I don't know. I think it's going to have to go that way. People are beginning to be aware of that.
Yeah.
You know,
it's
gotten as competitive as it could get. You know.
Yeah. You know, even if it's well-meaning and wanting the best for our generation, but losing sight of what it's supposed to be for.
Right. Right.
So, well, yeah, perhaps you'll have a camp for pre-college people to come out here and learn about priorities and de-stressing.
Yes.
You could very well have one here.
Yeah.
And so then there's work for you, Linda. And I know it's been an interesting path,
yeah,
right?
I've done a lot of different things. I worked with animals, a bunch of animal jobs in my 20s.
Now that's interesting, as you're surrounded by them now.
Yes, yes. I worked for the MSPCA.
Whoa.
And I worked for a pet store in Cambridge with birds. I used to breed parakeets and canaries and finches.
Wow, in your own home?
Yeah.
So you had a nursery of birds?
Yeah, I guess you call it more like an aviary.
Okay.
But I did do that, and I worked at the Franklin Park Zoo with the birds. And from that, I made a transition into teaching.
Okay.
Teaching history, because that was my background in my education was history, so... teaching history. Oh, look at everybody.
Everybody Everyone. Wants to tell a story here, right?
They do. They want to get involved.
So just again, you started with MSPC?
MSPCA, Angel Memorial,
Animal
Hospital.
Okay.
Yeah.
So protective nature of animals.
I was just doing clerical stuff, but that is the nature of Angel Memorial.
But you had some draw and love of animals.
Oh, yeah.
But then you went to what you studied in college.
Yes, because I was looking for a little bit more career-wise than I could get.
Okay.
With a liberal arts background.
Yeah. And so teaching history.
Teaching history in Holliston, and then had my children, took a little break from that. Teaching is very, very taxing.
Yes.
Very high demand. So I raised my children, and I did go back to school again for a master's in library information science with an archival emphasis, because that to get the history in there. So, so archival management is what my degree is.
We'll look to that, to go in that direction from direct teaching.
Well, it was a nice connection with the history, because I love history, and particularly the local history, or that type of history, history from the bottom up. And looking for some kind of a nice, comfortable career, so libraries. Yeah. And I did genealogy for myself and got very interested in that and thought, I could do that. I could help people research their family history. I'd love to do that.
And do you do that?
I do that. Do that a little bit
business?
At the library. Well, at the library.
Okay.
We get a lot of reference questions regarding people's backgrounds and their family histories
so
from Hopkinton.
And ask?
Well, or over the phone or via email. I work for the Historical Society also, and a lot of that is doing research, digging around in the archives for a connection, family connection that someone is interested in. Get your
ball. Okay, so that would be for people who have been living in Hopkinton and want to look back for their roots in the Hopkinton area.
A really excellent example of that was an Irish woman, very sweet woman, it's probably been a year now, contacted the Historical Society with a name of an Irish ancestor two or three generations back. Fahey was the family name, Margaret Fahey. And it just was like needle in a haystack, but we found her will at the Historical Society. And she had worked in the shoe factories and was probably a very poor woman initially. But she, upon her death, she sent $1,000 back to the little village in her home in Ireland where she'd come and had a spectacular marble statue created with that money. And we found that. She knew of the statue. She'd seen the statue, but we found the will drawing that whole thing out. So it was like... Mm. And so she came to America, came to Hopkinton, met with me. I showed her the will in person. Mm. We went to the graveyard. Found Margaret's grave in Mount Auburn Cemetery, but it was just amazing.
Yes,
you know?
It's like detective work.
Yes, and then we went to Snappy Dogs and had a hot dog to kind of round off the vacation. But her vacation.
Sounds
perfect. People do, people are really into that right now.
Yes.
And other than the internet, not everything is on the internet.
Right.
Some of these things are still on paper that has not been scanned and put out there. So you do have to go to these little societies or libraries and have people dig for you or do the digging yourself. Yeah, it's fun.
Well, that's great work and good to know. As for the library, a resource to find out about ancestors specific to Hopkinton area?
Right. It could be ancestors, it could be a piece of property where someone okay. lived, mm-hmm. or it could be someone having an interest in something that happened in the town, mm-hmm. you know, like mm-hmm. the Hopkinton Springs Hotel, you know, or a story that they'd heard of wanting to confirm the story. Mm-hmm. Or there are people writing books and want mm-hmm. Primary source materials for their books, so we do all of that.
Mm-hmm. So these are some great reasons why to have libraries still, which some might question
absolutely.
These days. We have the internet, we're all set.
Yeah, it's not all on the internet.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, yes. Or the internet might lead you to us, but then we have the actual papers and mm-hmm. artifacts.
Mm-hmm. And you have the people who care also,
right.
like yourself,
right.
it sounds like, to spend time with someone and mm-hmm. help them solve the mystery, create the story.
Yeah, yeah.
And what else happens at the local library? What reasons would you give, being witness? Why
sure,
we need libraries,
libraries
still?
Are changing and evolving with the needs of people. We have all kinds of people. We take for granted that everyone owns a computer, but not everyone owns a computer. Mm-hmm. People mm-hmm. are going through transitions in their lives, and maybe there's a divorce and the wife takes the computer.
Yeah.
But we, you know, do a lot with technology and teaching people, mm-hmm. seniors, how to use the technology. So we have a lot of that kind of traffic.
Mm-hmm.
And
well, that's good to know.
Yeah, it's books, and I love books. I love the referencing mm-hmm. questions with books, but we also have movies and music,
mm-hmm.
and we're even going to be loaning a telescope soon. So if you want to check out a telescope, you'll be able to check out a telescope.
Wow, and what might you see? I'm thinking stars.
I don't know, but stars and planets.
It's a powerful one?
I think so. They're going to be uh-huh. buying something good. But uh-huh. that's another kind of thing that libraries do.
Yeah.
I've heard of them in not this state, but, you know, where people rent out fishing rods.
Huh. Wow.
Sewing machines. But the big thing today is the technology.
Yeah. Well, that's interesting. It sounds like, in a way, loaning out some things that have been part of our past history, like sewing machines
right.
we don't always have
right.
in the house anymore, or fishing
right.
poles for that matter. So a great area of resource for people to have different kinds of experiences beyond just reading books, which
right.
I think is
right.
Important in
right.
itself. And the Hopkinton Library, where you work, is under a period of transition.
It
right?
is.
How's it going?
It's going well.
In
you know, it's,
a building,
it's,
a little
going,
building
yes.
in between, right?
Yep. Yep. So we're in a temporary location for perhaps another year, and then the new library hopefully will be open a year from this fall.
A year from the fall.
Yeah.
Okay.
But library is a place for programs, you know, for people to meet, all generations, all ages.
Yeah.
It's kind of unique in that regard. Everybody's welcome there, you know?
Everyone's welcome.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
you have programs going on, and I don't know, do you have a favorite library moment or story?
Well, for programs, we've had cooking programs, and we had a coloring group. Led by Mary. Mary did a coloring for adults.
For grown-ups.
We have a knitting uh-huh. group. Favorite moments? There's been a lot of them, you know.
Well, that's a good thing to
yes,
say.
Nothing in particular
yeah.
is popping
mm-hmm.
into my head, but
yeah. Well, it's good
it's a
hear.
Great place to run into neighbors and, you know, meet people that you wouldn't normally meet,
yeah.
you know, unless you bumped
mm-hmm.
into them in Kalela's or something, you know, but yeah.
And I know you're very helpful in knowing people and pointing out films or books they might
yes.
like, the new
yeah.
ones that come in.
Absolutely.
You're very good at that. And the Historical Society, you told a bit about your work there and helping people connect to the community and with history. And how about the Oral History Project that you're
yeah,
doing?
Yeah, that's
what
something.
What is it that you do?
It's kind of slowed down quite a bit, but yes, if people are interested, they can go to YouTube and see those recordings.
Okay.
But the idea is that we chat with people who have memories from the past.
Mm-hmm.
So 1930s, 1940s, 1950s, 1960s is in fact, yeah. You know, just to get a grasp on what it used to be like in the town.
Uh-huh.
So that you have a kind of a fuller, broader picture.
Yeah.
You can't really know where you're going unless you have at least some appreciation for what it was. And we are dramatically changing now, so these are important to know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like what did I learn? Where I grew up in Auburndale, we had garbage collection. I mean, I don't know if you did when you were a child, but a guy would come and he would run on foot and pick up the garbage, not the trash, the garbage, take it away. But I know that in this town, I guess up till the 60s, there was a pig farmer in the town. And the garbage would be picked up. Someone would pick it up. I don't know who his name was. People could tell me that or tell us that. And it went to the pig farmer.
Wow.
You know, and they fed the pigs. So,
that's,
you know, it was
up had to the 60s.
This, yeah, so that's sort of a rural flavor. And that's a great thing. I think we could go back to that, you know.
Mm-hmm. Right.
The chickens are...
The chickens are great.
Going to going at Mike there. They're pecking his
at the camera.
they want food. They're all about the food.
Maybe chicken, garbage for the chickens.
Yep, there. And I talked to someone else from Woodville, a little 12 years old. He had a chicken business. People would order chickens from him. They'd want one for that night. This is chickens to eat, not eggs. So they would get a chicken, kill the chicken humanely, I suppose, and then drive on his bike, deliver the chicken.
Chicken
and
delivery.
He did a good little business at 12.
Wow.
So, you know, and that's what it was like here. And that's a wonderful thing to know.
Mm-hmm. Very different.
Yeah, I mean, I don't, yeah. Yes, very different. Yep.
And using even our waste and keeping the cycle going that way rather than being waste, more wasteful.
Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah. And I learned too that people through the Oral History Project that, generally speaking, people's fathers, everybody worked together. There were a couple of different mills. There were locations in Milford, Westboro. So there really was a very tight-knit community, and it no longer is. You know, in some ways it might be. I mean, there are friendships and all that, but it was, you know,
a lot more cohesive,
family. Yeah, the parents.
Cooperative.
Yeah, working together also, you know?
Mm.
Oh, look at this. She's going to stare down the chickens.
Huh. And how about in working with the seniors, the elders of our town, what would you say that you learn from them as people in particular to offer to our community?
Very sweet group of people. As far as offering to the town, they offer a perspective in what things were like and what things ought to be like. I have a lot of respect for them.
Mm.
You know, if they can handle the kind of change that they've seen over their life's lifetime, and we certainly can, you know, take it easy.
And what our elders have dealt through and gotten through.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Wow. It sounds like good work that you are doing there and collecting the stories that we can hold on
to. There's some very, very interesting things.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the facts that they find uninteresting are most interesting to me, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's how it can go sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah, there was a threadmill in town. People would just walk and work to the threadmill. Oh, she'd plunge out.
Threadmill.
Yeah.
Uh-huh, creating thread.
Yeah, and that's Hayden Row. It's currently, there's a child care center there right now, but that's about to shift to residential housing again.
Okay.
But for a long time, there were factories in that building.
Mm.
Yeah.
Wow. It certainly has changed, and you're talking a lot about that today in looking at history and the work you've done and learned about. And, you know, and then I'm remembering what you said about how being outdoors helps us in coping with the changes in life. So you're offering remedy as well as telling us about getting through change here.
Right.
And any other hobbies or passions as we're closing up at
this
point?
Well, no, the animals and the history.
Animals,
you know, the animals and the local history.
Now, they have history also. These are all rescue animals that you found?
Well, not the chickens, but yes, she came from Indiana. She was from Bay Path, and Sylvester was from Arkansas.
Arkansas,
This one was from a parking lot in Milford.
A parking lot.
Wow. On Fortune Boulevard. Oh. The Marriott that is there. Mm-hmm. So someone must have just abandoned her. Well, she just was walking. You know, I saw her on that spit of land across the street from Wendy's, you know, as a kitten.
Oh.
Just playing there on this little, with traffic whizzing by. Mm-hmm. So I caught her in a have a heart trap.
Wow. Look how happy.
Yeah, she's a good cat. She's part of the pack. She
very
walks with us. Yeah.
That you make home.
And the chickens are.
And work and community. It sounds like you have contributed a great deal.
Well, thank you for saying so. It's a little bit, they're kind of little disjointed things, but I guess they can come together.
That's what I see, and learning a great deal from you. We have 1 minute left.
Okay.
And I was curious, since you work in the area of books, if you had opportunity to write any book you would want.
I'm interested in local, in slavery in this area. And to write something about slaves and their families, including Native Americans, because they were enslaved in the 1600s.
In
this area, I'm reading a book now. It would be really neat to do some research and put something together about that.
Uh-huh.
But there's very limited resources.
Very little,
but it is out there. So that's what I would like to do.
Perhaps that's next on your to-do list. But meantime, I wish you a wonderful rest
thank
of summer.
Thank you very much. You too.
And thank you
too. Nice to talk to you,
today.
Cheryl.
Nice to talk to you and all of your friends.
Okay. Take care.
They are beautiful.
All right.
Do you have what it takes?
Will you make a difference?
Always an adventure.
Police and fire working together.
Utilizing the latest technology.
Do you have what it takes?